Welcome to the Coalition of Scrubs, and yes, that was all of our collective natural voices singing.
Welcome back to the Coalition of Scrubs. I am your host for today from the Deck to the White team. And in today's episode we have an interesting deck that I've been fooling around with. And I think it's pretty cool. It's also somewhat competitive, really. I really enjoy playing this on online. I know online is not a technical play to test this, but whatever. And I think this deck could potentially become rogue if enough people play this, because actually this deck has some ways of battling with the meta, as you know. And what is there else to say? I really love this deck. First of all, I taken this idea from this video. This is a video from Yu-Gi-Oh. I know I'm not subscribed. I'm not, thankfully not. There we go. So this guy posted this Dogmatica Pruning Abyss video showing us how to play this deck that actually is a little bit more than just Beatrice Pass, and it has somewhat competitive relevance, really. So yeah, I like this deck. I like the combos that he made and everything, and now I'm going to show you what few changes I did to this thing just to make it a little bit more entertaining for me, at least. And let's look at those changes. Here we have it, folks. This is the full list. Obviously, our floor the list, Maximus, and two copies of Ecclesia, because you know the Dogmatica part is really funny. And obviously, Disciple of the Nadir or Nadir Servant is a really powerful card in this deck because it can search almost anything that you want from the thing that you sent to the graveyard from the extra deck. He plays one at least of each every Burning Abyss monster, because the names are really important in this. And you know, this is just Turbo Dante, so you need at least two of those. Rhino Warrior is great, as well as Tour Guide. You can also make Cherubini with the batteries, of course. And what I changed really about the ratios, apart from one or two Burning Abyss monsters, was the hand trap lineup. I decided to play Blossom and Ogre because these two are really powerful right now. And as well, he plays Forbidden Droplets, which is cool and nice. But I decided that Forbidden Chalice is, I don't know, just to make it look a little bit more budget friendly, because you know, Nadir Servant are expensive as well as impermanents. And finally, Shadow Rook. This is important because this is the Windalock. So you can search this with two cards, either Apkallon or Construct. With those two cards, you can search it. If you dump it with one of your mills from Dante, it's okay. And if not, you search it with Apkallon, discarding one card, it's fine. I mean, you just try to summon Wind as fast as possible. The reason why both Nadir Serpent and Maximus is important is because you want to send those two monsters, the Apkallon and the Construct, one to search the Rook and the other to banish, so you can fusion summon Winda. And you can send another thing, either Bastard, just to search Flor de Lis, Omega, to recycle one card from your graveyard. And yeah, pretty much basically it. IP Mascarena is important in this, as you saw in the picture that I chose, because this actually leaves the field with either Axis Codebreaker or Topologic Zeroboros. Whichever is more convenient to you, that's the play. And finally, just to avoid those inconvenient rocks that fall from the hand of your opponent. I played number 75, Bamboozing Gossip Shadow, because this deck can easily afford to play to both these monsters. But it is your choice. So now let's watch a couple of replays to show you how it works. First, we're going to play against Infernoids. You know, Infernoids are really cool. And as I said, this is good because we mill the rook. Graph is important, we're going to summon Seer from that. Make the Mask Arena, Dante Seer, of course, to make our Beatrice. Then with our Nadirs, we're going to add the rook. And then Ecclesia search for the Fleur-de-Lis. Maximus, he dropped to Entes. I was not expecting that, of course, because I didn't know what he was playing. But I mean, it's fine, we can still do a lot of things here. And we have almost basically everything, except that I didn't summon Maximus because I couldn't do that, or I forgot to do that, I don't remember really. But Chalice comes handy here because that would have killed me basically. We are still continuing to play. Monster Gate for Driver is not a good thing to do that. We're going to negate that. Cerberus pop that. We're going to banish the Cerberus just because we can and because we don't want him to link clamp. He's going to summon, it's okay. Banish, summon whatever you want, I don't care my guy. Go for second Dante. Build 3. Seer and Farfa, that's really good, that's really great. Now we're going to Maximus here. Another Entes, that's fine. And up Kaloon. Searching Rook. He vanishes, but whatever. I mean, it's fine. We have our two copies of Tour Guide. He destroys everything, but we fortunately can do a lot of stuff here. And we are still not out of the play. Tour Guide, summon Divich, go for Cherubini, Divich summon Seer, send Skarm with that, make Unicorn, discard that, summon, make Axis Cut, sorry, make Cerberus here, Bow Phase attack, End Phase search for another BA monster, and my opponent scoops because he has no other resources. So as you can see, this is a very resourceful deck, it has a lot of things to do. And you can easily recover from any misplay or any negation that your opponent has. The other thing I have here is a replay against Red Raptors. As I said, Ogre is really powerful here because that changes the line of play of our opponent. Getting just one card is okay, it's fine. I mean, make Dante, Dante send 3, grab summon 0, and again we continue playing. Of course, making the same basic combo, Ecclesia. Effect of Ecclesia doesn't get negated, so that's important. And I'm missing one extra deck monster, so that's why I didn't summon the Maximus. Droplet negating 2, I mean that's fine. We have Seer the Fleur-de-Lis, and our opponent scoops because Red Raptor doesn't have a lot of much of lineups if they don't have the way to special summon monsters. So as you can see, this is a really good deck in my opinion. It's really powerful, and you saw that you don't have to get your full board. And you can still win the games, fortunately. And I know you didn't watch meta like Emancipator and every stuff like that, but the replays that I got with that were really, really bad. Not because I lost, but because it was always bricky hands, and I didn't want to show you bricky hands from my opponents. And oh yeah, this is the way that they win because you're gonna brick. No. But anyway, I think this deck can really do much. And I hope that you give it a watch to the original video, of course, I will leave it in the description. Because there it is a little bit more explained, and you will see that there is not much to do with it. The ratios are really good. Maybe in the future, if when Phantom Rage games, you can play PK, Burning Abyss, Dogmatica, I don't know. But in the meantime, this is a good alternative if you don't want to play the Synchro build that I uploaded to my channel, be sure to check it out. And if you have obviously the resources to do that. Again, I'll ask you to check out every content creator in the Coalition of Scrubs. They make really good content, and be sure to follow everyone. And we upload videos sometimes, maybe just not all the times, and we do streams every 2 Fridays. But once again, thank you very much for your attention, and we see on the next video. Adios.